These are the faces of the doomed. In a corner of Canberra's war memorial, a wall of photos, almost 1,800 of them. Young Australian diggers, sons, brothers, husbands, even fathers, all of them fated to die a terrible death in the worst Australian tragedy of World War II, at a place called Sandakan in the steaming jungles of Borneo.
When you have 1,800 prisoners, Australian prisoners, and only six survived because they escaped, and you have almost 650 British prisoners and nobody survived, it has to rank up there as one of the great disasters from the Second World War, particularly as the method and manner of death was pretty appalling.
Sandakan in Borneo, the site of the worst of the Japanese prison camps, is now a memorial park to what historian Lynette Silver calls a terrible secret.
Things that were so bad that the Australian government decided deliberately not to tell the next of kin what had happened. And that's one reason why they haven't known for so long the details and the circumstances of this Sandakan story.
War has come to Singapore. In the wrecked and burning buildings, hundreds lie dead. Dead, too, is the comfortable myth of an impregnable fortress.
300,000 Allied troops surrendered with the fall of Singapore in 1942. They were committed to the unspeakable captivities of Changi, the Burma Railway, and now clearly the worst of all, Sandakan.
Just, you know, can't describe it. Just one big death house. A death house.
Keith Bottrell was one of only six men to survive Sandakan. They say history is written by the survivors, but in this case, there were precious few to write it and none now alive to tell it. Bottrell died a haunted man 10 years ago, but his terrible testimony lives on forever.
Everyone was sick. Dysentery, beriberi, malaria, scabies, malnutrition, and it smells, you can smell death. The smell of death was there all the time. We suffered a lot together. It brings you close. And I had to bury each one. I buried hundreds of good friends of mine, you know.
By 1944, Japan was losing the war in the Pacific. But in fact, that made things even more desperate for the Allied prisoners. At Sandakan, rations were cut back to virtually nothing, and the death rate soared.
Was there a decision made to kill all the prisoners towards the end?
Yes, there was a decision made at the end of 1944, whether it be by shooting or poisoning or hanging or whatever, it was to be done, and there was to be no one left afterwards. Annihilate them all were their words.
Since these men had to die, the Japanese decided to kill them with a purpose, to use them as pack animals for the Imperial Army's retreat through the mountainous jungles of Borneo. Back in the 1940s, this place was virgin forest and tropical wilderness. In what became known as the death march, the starving prisoners were forced to trek some 250 steamy kilometres through the roughest and most tortuous country on earth. It was about this time of year that they marched, and today it's 36 degrees, and unbelievably the humidity is just on 100%. Certainly to me it feels like it. I am melting. I don't think I'd last more than a few hours out here. But having said that, looking around, it is one of the most indescribably beautiful places on the planet. Not that the POWs saw it that way. The confining thickness of the vegetation around here, they described as a green cage, a cage from which only six men would ever escape.
And if you got sick and couldn't carry the rice, with beriberi in your legs, or you're too weak to carry on, they'd shoot you or bayonet you. For days on the march, we turn ourselves into a zombie. And you just didn't know you was marching or sleeping or resting, because there was no end to it. We never knew where we were going, which way we were going. Half the time you couldn't see the sun or the sky. I tell you what, it was pretty tough on a march. I'd sit down on the march up against a tree stump, and you just flop up against a tree stump, and you could feel yourself dying. You go into this, and if you woke up in the morning, you'd be surprised.
60 years later, the horrors of Sandakan still defy detailing. Crucifixions, castrations, hideous beatings and tortures, and, most unspeakable, cannibalism.
There were instances of them culling POWs from the pack, lopping off their arms and legs because they had too many sores, and taking the torsos downriver to their camp for human consumption, and they also killed and ate people at Pagnotan.
After the Japanese surrender, the Australian War Graves Unit moved in to recover the bodies. The government at last learned, but decided not to share the full extent of the disaster here. Because the truth was too awful, sons like Frank Murray were never told what happened to their fathers.
All the people I've met, the telegrams I received, all said they died of malaria. Didn't mention anything else.
Do you feel resentful about that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. How would you like somebody to come to you and not tell you the truth about what happened to your father?
The final count was 1,787 Australian bodies at the camp and along the jungle trail. Of the six men who escaped, three owed their lives to a rescue mission by Australian commandos.
Well, they were just ready to die. You couldn't describe just what they looked like. They looked like, to sum it up, skeletons with skin on them.
Lofty Hodges was in a party of Australian commandos parachuted into Borneo just before the Japanese surrender. He found three survivors, among them Keith Bottrell.
Picked him up like a baby because he only weighed not much more than a baby.
And you were a big bloke.
Yeah, I was at the time. I picked him up and nursed him like a baby and carried him back.
It still obviously haunts you.
It does.
The bond between these two men endured for a lifetime. And Keith Bottrell's evidence about what happened in Borneo was critical in the prosecution of 10 Japanese guards as war criminals. But it was one crime in particular, the murder of Private Richie Murray in May 1945, that most haunted Bottrell. It happened here at Ranau, where the death march ended, after the Japanese discovered the Australians had been stealing food.
Now, the Japanese guards, they were furious and they wanted revenge. So they marched out all 30 of the Australian POWs and lined them up here as in a firing squad and said to them, if you don't declare the guilty person, we'll shoot the lot of you. Can you imagine the tension at that moment along this line? Would the Japanese really do that? Well, Richie Murray thought that they would, given their track record, in what I think is probably one of the most brave acts I've heard of in Australian military history. He faced up to his Japanese guards and stepped forward.
He stood forward, took one step forward and said, I stole the food. And he knew that he would die. And they took him away and beat him up and bayoneted him to death. And
so there's never been as clear-cut a case of someone laying down their life for their mates as that.
Exactly. And he's the only person in this terrible story to voluntarily give his life up. And he did it knowing full well what was going to happen.
He stepped forward to sacrifice his life for his mates, lest we forget.
Do you write those lines?
Yeah.
Were they hard to write?
Yeah, yes. Very hard to write. Yeah, the more you think about it, the more it grips you.
For 50 years, Frank Murray never knew how his father died or where exactly he was buried here in the Borneo War Cemetery. But historian Lynette Silver was able to forensically backtrack through a mountain of wartime records to tell him not only the site of the grave, but also of his father's heroism.
It's a relief to know just where he is, how he died. And you get this opportunity to pay your respects.
While Frank has the story and the gravesite, many others, like Colin Pryor, have neither. His father, Leslie, lies among the legions of the unknown dead.
They never actually found his body. He just vanished. He was a rice carrier, and Lynette Silver thinks he just knew he was going to die and he crawled into the bush and vanished and never found any trace of him.
Would it be important to you to find him?
Oh, terribly important, yeah. It will start, you know, it's 3 years that you don't know what's happened to the man, and then you've got the rest of your life. You haven't got a role model or anything, you know. And you've got no one to follow, sort of thing, you know. And things happen to you all the time. You go to sports things, you're by yourself, or, you know, the boys got their fathers and you haven't.
What has always been needed to end this terrible story is a sense of redemption and recognition. That came last Anzac Day with the unveiling of a commemorative window at St Archan's St Michael's Church, funded entirely by the friends and relatives of the victims, and dedicated to remembering the bravery of those men whom history almost forgot.
They never, ever gave up the fight for survival, and that's why we should look on them actually as heroes here rather than victims.
Well, it is a triumph of the human spirit, isn't it?
The triumph of the human spirit over the weakness of the flesh. And with the window we've put in St Archan, that's what we hope to show, that it was a triumph of the spirit. I think that in time it has the potential to be the Second World War's Gallipoli. I think it will have the power to move those same sorts of emotion, that this is hallowed ground, this is where we did our best, we lost all these people, and a place of great emotion, I think.
You know, you look down there, and all other feelings mean nothing. Just as feeling of loss, try to understand it. Sometimes you think you will get over it, but no. I hope I don't get over it, because I don't want to turn into stone.
No. Thanks.
Good. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Charles Wooley. Thanks for watching. To keep up with the latest from 60 Minutes Australia, make sure you subscribe to our channel. You can also download the 9Now app for full episodes and other exclusive 60 Minutes content.